All right, man, this is a heavy one, guys. This is heavy. I'm not gonna lie to you. This sermon kicked my butt as God was giving it to me. Yeah, so let's pray, and we're gonna jump into this. Father, you are good. You are big. Father, and there are so many things about you that we don't understand. And there are so many things about you that are too great for us to comprehend. Lord, certainly without your Holy Spirit. And Father, we're going to look at things this morning. I pray, Lord, that you will be in our midst, that you will speak through me, that you will keep me far, far out of your way. Lord, as we look at difficult passage and talk about difficult things that are sensitive and scary, scary to hear, scary to say. Lord, as we look at your truth, the words on these pages, Lord, I pray your Spirit will have his way in each one of us. Convict us where we need it. Lord, open our eyes, illuminate your truth. Father, help us all to just tear down the walls that we put up and the barriers that we put up between us and you. Father, things that limit us from hearing what your Spirit wants us to hear. Father, I pray you'll do that this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Whew. All right, so normally I got like 9 pages of notes. And yesterday I had 15 pages of notes. I've whittled it down to 11. So we might move fast, but we might not. So go grab a sandwich, grab a pillow, settle down. This week we're in 2 Corinthians 9. Go ahead and turn there if you want to. We're continuing in our three-week mini-series called Overflow. If you were with us last week, you know that this series is a little bit different than ones we've done, at least in the recent past, in the last almost 3 years since I've been here. If this is only your second time with us, then it's not out of the ordinary because you were here last week and that's normal for you. But it's a little tricky. This series is on money. It's on money. And that's like the thing you're not allowed to talk about at church, right? Money and politics. You're not allowed to talk about those things. I might be with it in politics. But money is so tricky, especially when you talk about it from the pulpit. Trust me, I would probably rather be sitting down there this morning. And Gordon was very candid about that last week, just the trickiness, kind of the danger that we feel in this sensitive topic. And it really shouldn't be. I remember preaching a message on marriage a couple years ago maybe, and you could just like see the landmines all over the stage that I didn't want to step on. And I feel that way this morning. There's just kind of landmines all over the place. We're just gonna jump on some of them. We're just gonna kick them over, we're gonna blow ourselves up, and we're gonna see what happens. And it'll be fun. That being said, as you know, Pastor Gordon is in Nicaragua this week. He left on Thursday. He was apparently so worried about what I was going to say that he left the country. Literally fled the country along with Pastor David as well. And they may just never come back if they watch the video of this. No, I'm going to be honest here, though. So over the years, right, I've heard a lot of people say it. And it's true. I've heard a lot of people claim that they don't like to go to church because all they want is my money. And I've heard that over and over again. I was one of those people. In fact, I was one of those people before I ever went to church. I didn't go to church until I was 16 years old. I would watch preachers on TV every once in a while just to make fun of them, and all they asked for was money, and so that's probably where I got that idea. But I definitely was guilty of saying, oh, all they want is money. I was one of those people. Let me say something a little crazy this morning. We're going to say a lot of crazy things this morning. This is the first of them. And I just want to kind of throw this out there before we even get started. And this is really the whole point of the sermon. So I guess if you want to leave after I say this, you can, but please don't. God doesn't want your money. God doesn't want your money. God doesn't need your money. He is not in need. God is not up there like, I got all these plans, but I need a raise. Right? That is not God. He is not wanting for anything. He does not need our money. So just keep that in the front of your mind as we go through some things that are tough. that we kind of want to automatically put up this wall when we hear them. Know that, okay, I know this guy is saying these things and I don't like him, but I also know that he said earlier, God doesn't want my money, so I'm gonna hold on to that and I'm gonna roll with it. So why are we doing this series, right? Why are we doing this series Overflow? Gordon said this last week. We have a responsibility to teach the whole counsel of God, right? We have a responsibility to teach all of it, and we can't be afraid of it. And I'm not afraid. We're gonna jump into this. I'm not afraid. There is truth in every single word of Scripture. Every single word. And God talks about money all over the place, so we can't shy away from it. We can't hide from it. The truth is this. The truth is that how we view and handle our money is extremely important to God. Now, I say that keeping in mind that he doesn't want our money. Right? But the way we handle it, the way we view it, is extremely important to God. Not because he needs it, not because he wants it. Here's why. Here's why the way we view and handle our money is so important to God. It's because he desires something much, much more valuable. Something that is almost always found attached to our money. It's the reason why we are so sensitive about the topic. When God begins to pull on our money and the chain that it is tethered to, he finds at the other end what he's truly looking for. Our heart. Our heart. That's what he wants. Very, very much so. God wants our heart. And we as the church, right, agree with him. We're with him on that. Yes. I want God to have my heart, and I want God to have your heart at any expense, at any cost, and I don't mean monetary, I mean any cost. I want him to have our hearts. Matthew 6:21 says this. It says, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. The way we often cling to money and stuff is one of the best examples of us beginning to worship the blessing rather than the blesser. It's a plague and a serious hindrance to our spiritual growth when we begin to worship the blessing and replace him with stuff. We make idols. So a quick recap of where we were last week. If you're in 2 Corinthians, you're probably already there, chapter 9. Last week we did verses 1 through 5. This week we'll pick up in 6, but we'll go ahead and read 1 through 5. Quick recap. Here's what it says. Now it is superfluous. We'll stop right there. That's pretty good, wasn't it? Superfluous. I said it correct. I want to say superfluous. Incredibly fluous, very fluous, no. Superfluous, which means unnecessary. That's what it means. Now it is unnecessary for me to write to you about the ministry for the saints, for I know your readiness of which I boast about you to the people of Macedonia, saying that Achaia, which Corinth, right, who he's writing to, has been ready since last year, and your zeal has stirred up most of them. But I am sending the brothers so that our boasting about you may not prove empty in this matter, so that you may be ready, as I said you would be. Otherwise, if some Macedonians come with me and find that you are not ready, we would be humiliated, to say nothing of you for being so confident. So I thought it necessary to urge the brothers to go on ahead to you and arrange in advance the gift that you have promised, so that it may be ready as a willing gift, not as an exaction, which means to be demanded or coerced or given out of guilt. So what happened here? What is all that? What's going on right there? Paul had bragged about their generosity, right? Paul had bragged to the church in Jerusalem about their generosity and was giving them kind of a heads up, kind of saving his own butt. He didn't want to be embarrassed. I don't want to be embarrassed. He said, you wouldn't be embarrassed. I would be embarrassed. Kind of, you guys got my back on this, right? And it was an honest boasting. It was an honest boasting. It was not manipulative or coercive. He genuinely believed they meant what they said when they promised. He was boasting in confidence. A good example of that is, so we have this envelope fundraiser for the youth missions, right, in the back over there. And when Lewis brought that idea to me and to Gordon, we discussed it. I thought, man, that is a brilliant idea. I wish I could take credit. Maybe he found it on Pinterest. I don't know what he did. Maybe, I'm sure he's on Pinterest a lot, you know. No, no. But it's a brilliant idea. And he brought that to us, and I said, man, that is great. And I think it's going to work. And I boasted of your generosity. And I reminded him, like, when we did the Bibles for the pastors in Nicaragua, right, I reminded him, hey, when we did that, Pastor David got up here and he just said, here's the need. And before the next week even began, services began, we were done. You guys had met that need. You're like, boom, we're going to do it. And so I boasted to Lewis about your generosity. And what's going on right now? Pastor Dave and Pastor Gordon are down there giving the fruits of your generosity. So that's what was going on here in verses 1 through 5. So where are we this week? Okay. 2 Corinthians 9, starting in 6. We're gonna read through this 6 through 15, and then we'll go through piece by piece and kind of break it out. He says, the point is this. Now, I love it when this happens, because oftentimes we read scripture and we go, what's the point? Well, here he starts out with, the point is this. He spells it right out. The point is this. Whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work. As it is written, he has distributed freely, he has given to the poor, his righteousness endures forever. He who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way to be generous in every way, which through us will produce thanksgiving to God. For the ministry of this service is not only supplying the needs of the saints, but is also overflowing. Where have I heard that word? Overflowing. Oh, yeah. It is overflowing in many thanksgivings to God. By their approval of this service, they will glorify God because of your submission that comes from your confession of the gospel of Christ and the generosity of your contribution for them and for all others. While they long for you and pray for you because of the surpassing grace of God upon you, thanks be to God for his inexpressible gift. So there's like a whole sermon series just right there. But unfortunately, we only have 2 more hours left. Yeah, all right, let's do this, yeah. All right, so what's going on here? First, verse 6. The point is this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. What images come to your mind when you hear that or when you read that? This idea of you sow bountifully, you'll reap bountifully. You sow sparingly, you'll reap sparingly. What kind of images come to mind? Think about that for a second. Some may be negative images, some may be positive images. If I'm honest, the first thing I think of is more negative things, because I've heard bad teaching on this, quite honestly. Not here, other places. And so negative things kind of come to mind. But here Paul's expanding on a well-known proverb, you reap what you sow. Right? We've all heard that a million times, you reap what you sow. It's biblical, it comes from scripture. It's sprinkled all throughout the Old Testament and New Testament. One place, for example, here is in my favorite Old Testament book, Hosea chapter 10, verse 12. He says, sow for yourself righteousness, reap steadfast love, break up your fallow ground, for it is time to seek the Lord, that he may come and rain righteousness upon you. Sow for yourself righteousness and reap steadfast love. Right? Break up fallow ground, till the soil up and sow good seed. The point he is making here is that the size of the harvest is proportional to the amount of the seed sown. Right? He's just using an agricultural analogy. They're all over the place. As he was speaking to people who understood that. It's very simple. The amount of seed that is sown is proportional to the harvest. All things being equal, it's going to be the same, right? You're not going to plant one seed and expect the entire field to grow, right? And you don't put seed out all over the place and then you're surprised that there's harvest all over the place. So he's drawing that point. What he's saying is be generous to others and God will be generous to you. Give what God has given you and God will be generous to you. What he is not saying is this, What he is not saying is if you sow $50, he'll give you $1,000. He's not saying that. I don't even know what that means. Like, how do you sow 50? Well, you bury a $50 bill? And I've heard this so many times, though, I have to kind of address it here. Sow a seed of 50 and God will give you $1,000. That is not what he's saying. It's not at all what he's saying. Now, you may have done that somewhere down the road. You may have given $50 or $100 to anything, and then God has poured out onto you tenfold. He can totally do that. And he does do that. He can totally do that. I would not deny if you say that has happened to you. Not at all. He's given me way more than I have ever given him and deserved. So I totally get that. But that is not what this is about. That is not the promise that he is making. That is not the blessing that he's talking about when we sow. It's not what he's saying. It's also very important when we read verses like this, sow sparingly and you will reap sparingly, sow bountifully and you will reap bountifully. It's important to know that there's a huge difference in the way that we sow. Massive difference. That which we sow in the flesh, we will reap in the flesh. That which we sow in the spirit, we will reap in the spirit. That distinction kind of makes or breaks this whole thing. What does that mean? They're very different things and they have very different rewards, consequences, and outcomes. One is temporal and one is eternal. Your motive determines that. Matthew 6, 1 through 4 shows us a very clear picture of this. Matthew 6, starting in 1. Beware of practicing your righteousness before other people in order to be seen by them. For then you will have no reward from your Father who is in heaven. Thus, when you give to the needy, sound no trumpet before you as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may be praised by others. Truly, I say to you, they have received their reward. Why? Who's saying, you know, don't go grab an envelope. Don't go grab the $100 envelope and walk through the lobby like, hey, guys, I got the $100 envelope. Right? Don't do it in order to show men that you have done it. Because if you do that, you've gotten all of your, that's your reward, right? Men praising you, that's your reward. You reaped in the flesh. You sow in the flesh, you reap in the flesh. It's good also to recognize that when we approach tough passages like this, it's a tricky one, it is, that we're careful about the baggage that we bring in with us, right? Every one of us comes in on a Sunday morning with baggage. Things we've heard before, things we've read before. Some of it's very good and very true. Some of it is not so much. And we bring it all in with us. One baggage would be all the church wants is money. Yep, that's baggage. That's baggage. We bring it all in with us. And we start to kind of filter what we hear. When we look at Scripture, we filter it through these lenses that we've made. And it's so important that those lenses are clear and that they're accurate and that they're true, right? And the Bible is the only thing that we can interpret the Bible with, right? We don't, oh, this guy said this and I like that better, so I'm going to apply that. No, it doesn't work like that. And here's some of the baggage we bring in specifically when it has to do with these types of things. For some reason, we are all prone to equate God's blessing with financial gain, with money and with stuff, right? When we think of God's blessing, that's one of the first things. Well, money and stuff. Well, hey, I got a new car. Yes, I'm very blessed. I got a raise. Oh, God has blessed me so greatly. Those are true statements, right? But when we tie God's blessing down to money and stuff, whoo, man, we go down a dangerous path and we miss so many things that he's doing. We get a lot of stuff wrong. Why do we do that? Why are we so prone to connect blessing, God's blessings with money and stuff? I think it's because, as far as tangible rewards go, money is the best thing this world has to offer. Money is the best thing this world has to offer, and it's not much. Sure, we value love and friendships more than money, right? Right? We value love and money more than, or love and friendships more than money. Unless it's a lot of money. Right? Yeah, that nervous laughter means it's true. Yeah. Yeah. Now, I'm not saying, every relationship. I'm not saying that. But think about this for a second. If I were to offer you $6 billion. $6 billion. Never to talk to your best friend again. See you later. It'd be a tough decision. It'd be a tough decision, right? To be honest. Think about it. Our culture, what do we chase? What does our culture chase? Money. Stuff. More. We just chase more. I don't even know what it is. I just want more of it. I might need more of it later. He has more than I do, so I need more than he has. That's what we chase. Americans have an average of $90,000 of debt per household. $90,000 of debt per household. That is a lot of debt. And that's counting the ones that have no debt, right, mixed into it to even it all out to get the average. $90,000 of debt per household, about 6,000 of which is credit card debt, which is just stuff I want enough to put on a credit card, but not stuff enough I want to pay for. Right? $6,000 in credit card debt is average. Our national debt is approaching $20 trillion. I just gotta say, I don't even know what that means. That is an absurd number. Someone told me the last service it's 12 zeros. That's a lot of zeros. I can't even picture that. I can't count that high. 20 trillion. You can get online, you can go to like debt calculator, and it's just this rolling thing that's constantly going. It goes so fast you can't even see the numbers. I would advise you not doing it. It'll just make you sick. My point is this: you can't tell me that money hasn't gotten a hold of us. Can't tell me money hasn't gotten a hold of us. It's burrowed itself deep into our hearts to the point where separating the two means our heart is going to have to fundamentally change. Separating money from our hearts is so difficult that in order to do it, our hearts are going to have to fundamentally change if we're going to let go of it. This is why we equate God's blessing with money. We think it's the best God has to offer because it's the best the world has to offer. It's often what our flesh wants more than anything else. But it will never satisfy. No amount will satisfy. I mean, look at Hollywood, look at the record industry, look at pro athletes. That went well, right? You get all the money, your life is perfect. All your relationships work out. There's no drug rehab centers in Hollywood or Nashville, right? I'm telling you, it doesn't work. Here's the thing. Here's the thing, and write this down if you're taking notes. If we think money or material gains are the pinnacle of God's blessing to us, we know nothing of his goodness. If we think money or material gains are the pinnacle of God's blessing to us, we know nothing of his goodness. Think about that. Now, there are barriers to us that we are for us that we hold back when it comes from giving generously. There's reasons why we don't. There's these big barriers that we have to get over. We're terrified of it. We're terrified of giving generously. And there's no number attached to that. There's no number attached to generously. I'm terrified of it. What does generous mean? How much is generous? Just give me a number, God. There are things we have tethered ourselves to that prevent us from moving towards God unhindered. And when we tether ourselves to money and to stuff, when we value and our value and our worth is tied to that, which it is, right? Or your neighbor gets a new car, well, I need to get a new car, or I need to push his off a cliff. Right? Our identity is tied to that. When we tether ourselves to things, it anchors us securely to our flesh. If God's will is over here, and if living in the Spirit is over here, and giving myself up is over here, and I'm tethering my heart to money or stuff or status or whatever it would be over here, I need this job, I need that job, I need this car, I need that, whatever it is. We tether our hearts to this. We can't get over there. We can't get to what he wants because we won't let go of what we think is so important. What prevents us from giving generously? And remember, there is not a dollar amount attached to that. We have to stop thinking of it that way. Like, well, what's the magic number? There's no magic number. I have no idea. God may be calling you to give every penny, and he may be calling you to give one penny. That is between you and him. I have no clue. No clue. And I'm not even talking about giving to the church. Like, that's not what I'm talking about. This is much bigger than that. This is God, what I have is yours. Where shall I put it? Anywhere is fair game. We have to stop thinking of it in terms of give me a dollar amount, give me a checklist so I can say I obeyed the rule and I can move on. No, we have to stop making new laws for ourselves and start letting the Holy Spirit speak to us. Do what he says. So what are these barriers? Fear and pride are our barriers. And I know that because that's what God revealed to me that are my barriers. Those are pretty much the barriers we put up at everything, fear and pride. We fear if we give too much, we won't have enough. Well, how much do I need so I can give out of what I have left? Yeah, okay, that's not a stupid thing to do. But we let that dictate our fear. We think if I don't have a certain amount, I'm less valuable than those who have more. These are the lies that we're told. I say this often. It's a quote from my theology professor who I think stole it from somebody else, but this is the lie we're told. Get all you can all you get, sit on the can. That's what we're supposed to do, right? All right, what's our lot in life? Get all I can all I get, sit on the can. We fear we won't have enough. We won't have enough. We won't have enough for what? Like really, what won't we have enough for? For what we want? For our own plans? That might be true. If we give the way God asks us to give, we might not have enough for our plans. Fair. But do we honestly believe that we can give so much in the Spirit? Meaning that through prayer and with the desire to give God the glory and nothing else, that we can give so much that he won't give us enough to fulfill his purpose in our life. So you say, okay, I know that God he wants me to give over here to this person or to that thing or whatever. I know that God wants me to do that, and I want him to have the glory in that. I don't want any of the glory for myself. I want to do that. But I'm afraid that if I do this thing to glorify God, which God has compelled me to do, that I won't have enough money to do the things that God wants me to do. Have we convinced ourselves that that is true? The truth is that if we freely give for God's glory, we will always have enough for what he has called us to do. We're going to come back and look at that in a little more detail here in a few minutes. But that's the we can't outgive God kind of mentality. But he can very much ask us to give things that will cause us not to be able to do our plans. Here's where we're going to get in a lot of trouble right here. I better stop and take a drink. This is trouble. I often hear people say this, and I have said this. So put me in the seat right next to you. Well, I need to be a good steward. I need to be a good steward. That's true. It's absolutely true. We need to be good stewards. We need to be good stewards of what God has given us, and that's everything he's given us. That's relationships. That's money. That's jobs. Everything we have is a gift from him, and we need to be good stewards of all of it. Absolutely true. But all too often, if we are honest, or if you're like me, sometimes that becomes something that we just hide behind, not something we're prayerfully putting into practice. I'm pretty sure I'm not the only person that's ever done that. If I am, then I'm very embarrassed. But I'm not. In our eyes, all too often by our standards, right, this is true, the woman in Matthew 26 who poured out the alabaster jar, which was worth a ton of money, all over Jesus' head, was a horrible steward. And put ourselves in that situation. Put ourselves there. This is what it says in Matthew 26, starting in verse 6. Now when Jesus was at Bethany in the house of Simon the leper, a woman came to him with an alabaster flask of very expensive ointment, and she poured it on his head as he reclined at the table. And when the disciples saw it, the disciples, not the Pharisees, the disciples saw it, they were indignant, saying, "Why this waste? For this could have been sold for a large sum and given to the poor." Which side of that would we have been on? I'd have been right there with them. Like, why'd you do that? You know how much money that's worth? you could have sold that and given all this money to, and then I could have had a little extra. We could have gotten some camels to ride around so that my sandals don't wear out. That one went by and then came back around. Guys, this is the thing. They couldn't understand the value of her sacrifice because they didn't understand the position of her heart. And they underestimated the value of the one that she was pouring it on. They underestimated the value of the one she was pouring it on. And we do that. This is Jesus' response. Jesus, aware of this in verse 10, said to them, "Why do you trouble the woman? For she has done a beautiful thing to me. For you always have the poor with you, but you will not always have me. In pouring this ointment on my body, she has done it to prepare for my burial. Truly I say to you, wherever this gospel is proclaimed in the whole world, what she has done will also be told in memory of her." This is a perfect example of that. Guys, she did something crazy. Crazy. Because all she cared about was worshiping Jesus. That is all she cared about. And guys, sometimes we need to be reminded that we're allowed to do crazy things. We are allowed to do crazy things. But sometimes we're afraid to do the crazy things because the other people who are afraid to do the crazy things are going to judge us for doing the crazy thing, so we don't do the crazy thing. Do the crazy thing. I think sometimes God is up there just like, jump. Do the crazy thing. You're compelled to do it for a reason. Don't be afraid. Let them judge you. Do the crazy thing. From the world's perspective, and sometimes ours, the woman in Luke 21 who gave her last two coins wasted them. Honestly, she gave no significant financial contribution whatsoever. Financial. She gave two coins that totaled one penny. We look at that like, why'd you bother walking over here to put that in? A lot of times that's how we see it. What was Jesus' response? What did he say when he saw her? Luke 21, 3 and 4. "Truly I say to you, this poor widow has put in more than all of them." Mathematically, that's not true. Right? Mathematically, it's almost impossible to put in less than she did. But he wasn't talking about numbers. He wasn't talking about percentage. He wasn't talking about how much money. It was far, far beyond that. "This poor widow has put in more than all of them, for they all contributed out of their abundance, but she, out of her poverty, put in all she had to live on." If we want a standard, then there's your standard. Thank God for grace. Guys, God operates in a whole different economy than we do. Whole different economy. So we have all these barriers, right? We don't want to be crazy, because then everybody's going to judge us, and we just can't go out that far on the limb. I don't want to jump. We have all these barriers, and what is Paul's response to them? What does Paul say about this? In verse 7 through 9, he reminds us of something very important, and he encourages us with truth. He says this in verse 7, "Each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver." This is more trouble we're going to get in right here. If you're giving out of compulsion from anyone other than the Holy Spirit, right? If the Holy Spirit compels you, then do it. But if someone else is compelling you to do it and it's not of the Spirit, or if you're giving reluctantly, or if you're giving begrudgingly, that's not what God asks for. That's not what he's asking for. If you're giving out of guilt, don't. Don't give. If you're doing it out of guilt, it doesn't count as pleasing the Lord. It's clearly not the amount that he's worried about, right? If this little widow put in a penny, he's not worried about how much. He's worried about the heart. And if your heart is, "I'm going to give this because I feel guilty," that doesn't count as pleasing to the Lord. Then he encourages us in verse 8. He says, "God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work." Abound in every good work, as it is written, "He has distributed freely. He has given to the poor." What has he given to the poor? His righteousness, which endures forever. Again, what are the main reasons for us not giving? Pride and fear. We're afraid if we give generously, we won't have enough, or we won't have a status, or whatever it is. Again, if we give for God's glory, freely without compulsion, we will always have enough for the good works that he has prepared for us in advance. We may not have enough for the new car or the three-week vacation in Montana. I'm sorry, baby, I'm working on it. That's not the promise that he gives, though. The promise is that we will always have enough for his call on our life. That's Paul's response to those barriers. Verse 10, he says, he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. The promise that God will increase the harvest is not referring to material gain. I don't think I can say it enough. The promise he gives of increasing the harvest is not referring to material gain. It's referring to spiritual gain, which is far more valuable. It is eternal, not temporal. God promises that he will use his people and their resources as instruments of his grace and to lead others to salvation, which can be found only in Jesus Christ. Guys, obedience to God always results in blessings. Always, always, always. Blessings for ourselves and blessings for others. Others who had nothing to do with it. Your obedience will bless someone who doesn't even know you. Your obedience could bless someone who doesn't even know God. And remember, we're not talking about financial blessings. We're talking about real spiritual fruit. So what kind of spiritual fruit? What kind of spiritual fruit does Paul say is produced specifically through cheerful giving? He spells it right out here in verse 11 through 13. And this is a big deal. This is where it all comes together. Starting in verse 11, he says, you will be enriched in every way to be generous in every way, which through us will produce thanksgiving to God. For the ministry of this service is not only supplying the needs of the saints, but is also overflowing in many thanksgivings to God. By their approval of this service, they will glorify God because of your submission that comes from your confession of the gospel of Christ and the generosity of your contribution for them and to all others. So there are three things that Paul says are three fruits that will be born out of us giving bountifully and generously. First, the needs of others will be met. Shocking. The first one, the needs of others will be met. Second, overflowing thanksgiving is poured out onto God. And third, he is glorified. Those are pretty good. Those are pretty good fruits. So the first one, the ministry of the service will supply the needs of the saints. This is quite simple. They had little and they were in need. They had plenty, they gave it, they were no longer in need. Amazing. I think we kind of get that, right? We kind of get that. And we think, well, that makes me feel good. It should. That's good. It should make you feel good. That's good. But that is the start. That is just phase one. That's the first kind of easy thing that we see very tangibly. The second thing, they will be overflowing in many thanksgivings to God. Remember, Paul is collecting this gift from Gentile believers in Corinth to give to Jewish believers in Jerusalem. This is quite remarkable. Right? The two churches that he's doing, the audiences that are there, the implications of this blew their minds and resulted in a greater humility and understanding of God's goodness. Imagine getting a gift in your time of need, right? Your worst time of need. You get a gift from a church in Iraq or a church that's being persecuted tremendously in China, right? And you get that gift. You'd be like, well, that's what's going on here. And third, by their approval of this service, they will glorify God. Why? Why? Because of your submission, because of your obedience, by your clear confession of the gospel of Christ, proven by your generous action, proven by your obedience. What you claim to be true about Jesus and what you claim to be true about the gospel is proven, as evidence is given by your actions, by your generous actions. You say, that guy believes what he says. And God is glorified by that. It's as simple as that. God will be glorified. Guys, that is all we want. That is all we want, is for God to be glorified. Everything else is gravy, frosting. Hopefully not both at the same time. That'd be gross. Everything else is extra. I'm going to make some gravy frosting now. Bring it in next week. Guys, God does not command believers to give a certain amount of money. He provides opportunities for us to give generously. I know some of you are like, wait, what did you just say? God does not command believers to give a certain amount of money. He provides opportunities for us to give generously all over the place. Those who sow bountifully in response to the Holy Spirit and for the glory of the Father will reap bountifully. They will bear spiritual fruit. That's what that means. So as we said at the beginning, God speaks to us so much about money, not because he needs it, right? He's not trying to figure out how to do things, but he's broke. But because he pulls on the chain that it's tethered to and he finds at the other end our hearts. That is why we are sensitive to hear about it, and that is why I am terrified to teach on it, because it's connected so tightly to our hearts. And Paul ends this section with this, verse 14 and 15. He says, while they long for you and pray for you because of the surpassing grace of God upon you, thanks be to God for his inexpressible gift. I think, well, that's a weird way. It's a weird way of ending that. Thanks be to God for his inexpressible gift. What gift is that? Right, he's talking about all these gifts all kind of tied into that. What gift is that? What's the point of it all? Why are we able to give freely? What compels us and drives us and really frees us to be able to give generously? What is that inexpressible gift? The gift that every gift we ever give is simply an expression of. The ultimate gift of God, Jesus Christ, our substitute and redeemer. That's what he's talking about. If you go back just one chapter into 2 Corinthians 8, verse 9, he says, for you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that you, by his poverty, might become rich. Now, clearly this is not talking about money, right? This is not talking about money. God has given us salvation through Jesus Christ. And here's the thing. He did not die to bring us money and material wealth. If anyone ever sells you that gospel, reject it and walk away. It's garbage. Jesus did not die to bring us money and material wealth. He died to free our hearts from pursuing money and material wealth. To break the tether that ties our hearts to all this world has to offer and to tie it back to the only one who can truly satisfy himself. We look at it all backwards. We'll end with this. He died to free us, right? From sin, from his wrath, from our idols. He wants our hearts, not our money. But our money can so easily become an idol. And God wants us to put all of our trust in him, all of it. We're so prone to put our trust in money. Isn't it ironic that as we're so prone to put our trust in money, right, the one thing we trust the most, it's so ironic that printed right on it is, in God we trust. And it's kind of ridiculous. Matthew 6, I love this. This is the playing out of all that. It says, do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. In verse 24, no one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money. Therefore, I will tell you, do not be anxious about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not more valuable than they? And which of you, by being anxious about what? About money and about food and about clothes and about cars and about jobs, and you just name it. Which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to his life? And then down in 30, O you of little faith, do not be anxious, saying, what shall we eat? What shall we drink? What shall we wear? For the Gentiles seek after all these things. And by this he means at that time, the people who didn't even know him, people that don't know him seek after those things. Your Heavenly Father knows that you need them. And this is it right here. Verse 33. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you as well. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Matthew 6:33 says the same thing we've been saying since the beginning of January. It's the same thing. This theme seems to go all over the Bible. Maybe it's true. Focus on abiding, not the fruit. Focus on abiding, not the result. When we focus on abiding, seeking first his kingdom, God will take care of the fruit and he'll take care of us. All these things will be added. Guys, our Father knows what we need far better than we do. Far better than we do. And he knows that some of the things we want will only bring trouble. And he knows some things that we don't want, he's going to conform our hearts to want them. And one day we wake up and we say, man, God has given me the desires of my heart. Yeah. Yeah, because he's conformed your heart to want what he has. Our Father knows our needs way better than we do. Way better than we do. And we can trust that everything we have comes from him. He is the supplier. We are not the supplier. We are not. It's so easy to lose focus on that. Let's pray. Father, we thank you again for your goodness and your grace. Lord, thank you for the way you provide for us. Lord, in so many ways. Father, thank you that your word is true, that we can anchor ourselves in it, and that we can trust in that. Lord, I pray this week that you will give us increased faith to do the crazy things. Lord, whatever those things are, whatever context they're in, Lord, if there's a barrier that we haven't crossed over because we're just too afraid, Father, that can have nothing to do with giving, just in general, Lord, show us that and give us the faith and the boldness to jump. We thank you for your goodness and grace. In Jesus' name, amen.